All right, in Romans chapter 5, verse 20, Paul spoke of God's grace superabounding in the face of the increase of sin that was occasioned by the law. And from that, some might think that Paul was implying that one should remain in sin, that one should remain under sin's control so that grace may increase. Then in chapter 6, verses 1 through 14, Paul rejects that idea completely and absolutely. He says that our baptism into Christ was a pivotal event that not only freed us from the guilt and condemnation that we had earned by our sinning, but also freed us from sin's power. See, and that's an important thing to grasp. We are raised from the participation in Christ's death that takes place in our baptism. We are raised from that participation in death, he says, to walk in newness of life, to live life in a new state, a state that is marked by the new age realities, such as empowerment by God's Spirit. The old man, who we were in Adam, as condemned sinners, has been crucified with Christ so that we may no longer serve sin as slaves. So this idea that, well, are you implying that we ought to stay in sin? Paul says absolute nonsense. And he says in 6:1-14 that as Christians we're constantly to regard ourselves, to consider ourselves, to hold on to the truth as having been freed from sin's claim on us, and as being in a relationship with God that no longer suffers from sin's alienating effect. We are to consider ourselves that way, recognize that reality. And with that understanding, he says, we must not allow sin to rule us. See, we must not allow it. Sin to rule, what he says, our mortal bodies. And we must not offer our bodily members to be used as weapons of unrighteousness. We are not to put our bodies at the disposal of sin. So far from encouraging sin, far from saying that, it's the exact opposite. We must constantly avoid using our bodies in the service of sin. Sin, Paul says, will not exercise lordship over us because we're under the new covenant, in which we've been separated from the power of sin by dying to sin in Christ and being empowered by the Spirit to live for God. Now, he's going to have much more to say about the role of the Spirit in this new age and what he is to do in our lives. Then in this last part of chapter 6, verses 15 to 23, Paul makes clear that the fact Christians are not under the Mosaic law, not under the old covenant, doesn't mean they're lawless or immoral. This idea that we're no longer under the old covenant, it's not a choice of it's either Judaism or immorality. Those aren't the choices. You see, that's as I said last week, that's a false dichotomy. On the contrary, see, Christians have been freed from sin, freed from the enslaving powers that would prevent us from becoming what God wants us to be, and we have been enslaved to righteousness. We serve God wholeheartedly. So that's what where we are at the beginning of chapter 7. What up, brother? I can't see you. Beginning of chapter 7. Paul says, or do you not know, brothers? For I speak to those who know the law, that the law exercises lordship over a person for as long a time as he lives. For the married woman has been bound to her living husband by the law, but if the husband should die, she's been released from the law of the husband. Now therefore, while the husband is living, she will be called an adulteress if she comes to belong to another man, but if the husband should die, she's free from the law, so that she's not an adulteress after coming to belong to another man. So, my brothers, you also were put to death to the law through the body of Christ, so that you might come to belong to another, to the one who was raised from the dead, so that we might bear fruit to God. For when we were in the flesh, the sinful passions aroused through the law were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we've been released from the law, dying to that in which we were held, so that we serve in newness of the Spirit and not in oldness of the letter. Paul says here, he had said in chapter 6, verse 14, that Christians are not under the law. In chapter 6, verse 14. Then in verses 15 to 23 of chapter 6, he immediately explained that that doesn't lead to sin. You see, when you say somebody that we're not under law, you say, okay, well, you're saying then we're lawless. No, 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 that's not the choice. We're not under law, but that fact doesn't lead to sin. Well, now Paul elaborates on the assertion that Christians are not under law. And I think Paul's real target here are the Roman Christians who believe that the law was applicable to Christians. Jewish Christians in Rome, this is who I think Paul has in mind, those Christians in Rome who think that the Mosaic law is applicable to Christians. And you know, this was a big deal in the early church. Paul was facing this all the time. There was this question of how does Christianity interface with Judaism? And so you see that pop up all over the place. You see it in Acts, you see it in Galatians, you see it in Corinth. You see these issues and these questions arising. And though the Roman Christians as a whole, the Roman Christians would have been familiar with the Mosaic law, those who were urging the Mosaic law's ongoing validity, they would have been especially identified with it. You see, and that's why I think when he sits here, when he says, for I speak to those who know the law. Well, they all would have had some understanding of the law, but those who were urging its ongoing validity, they would have been considered, and they would have considered themselves as the most knowledgeable about the law. So that's the signal I get. That's his interest to me when he says that, that he's focusing on that group. And Paul asks if those with knowledge of the law, or if they're ignorant of the fact that the Mosaic law, like law in general, that it applies only to the living. In fact, there was a rabbinic saying, which it's hard to know when these things start, but there was a rabbinic saying that may have been known at Paul's time, when the time he's writing this. The rabbinic saying is, if a person is dead, he is free from the Torah, free from the law and the fulfilling of the commandments. And so Paul is saying, look, you guys who know the law, you people who are really the real guys who are into the law and urging its ongoing applicability to Christians, that's me reading that into that, but I think that's what he's talking about. Don't you know, don't you understand that the law only applies to the living? And then he illustrates that. He illustrates that principle with a reference to the marriage relationship, because he wants them to see, don't you get, you who are urging the ongoing applicability of the law, don't you understand that it only applies to the living? And then he gives this example here, the death of a wife's husband freed her from the law's obligation regarding her husband so that she was free to remarry. Okay, she's that if the husband dies, she's free to remarry. But if she married somebody while her husband was still alive, and of course the assumption is that either she's had no divorce or no divorce that permits remarriage, he doesn't have to say that. But if she's married and she goes ahead and comes to belong to another person, well then she's going to be called an adulteress. She's going to be one in violation of the law. But if the husband dies and she comes to marry somebody else, to belong to somebody else, she's not called an adulteress because his death frees her from that legal obligation. And so this is what Paul, this is what he's doing. And the point that Paul is making is that just as the wife was freed to be joined to another by her husband's death, so those who were championing the Mosaic law, its ongoing applicability, they had been freed to be joined to Christ by sharing through baptism in the death of Christ. See, they had been freed from, through that death, they had been freed from their obligation to Moses, freed to be joined to Christ. And so this is the idea, the point that Paul's making. The purpose of that union was Christ, with Christ, was that they might bear fruit to God. Now, if you're following this, you say, well, wait a minute, there's a little bit of difference here in the illustration, because in the illustration, the wife is freed from, she's freed from the law by the death of her husband. But Paul's not concerned with that. You see, he's not concerned in the illustration with the fact the wife is freed from the law by the death of another, by the death of the husband. The point is that death removes legal obligations. And in fact, the fact that the wife remains alive in the illustration he's doing, that actually serves Paul's purpose, because it leaves her alive so that she can then be joined to another. You see, so it actually serves the purpose that Paul is making. That, so yes, she's freed by the death of another. The point being, death severs legal obligations. But he has her alive now so that she can function in that capacity, that she's free to belong to another, as believers are free by their death to the law through Christ to belong to another, to bear fruit to God. So that's the point that how Paul is using the illustration there. And Paul, I think, he focuses on Jewish Christians, those who had died to the Mosaic law, because the Gentile Christians hadn't been under the Mosaic law. I think that Paul focuses on Jewish Christians, on those who died to the Mosaic law in converting to Christianity. And you can see that, like, in Galatians chapter 2, verse 15 and verse 19. You see these Christians, Jewish Christians, when they convert, they died to the law. I think he focuses on them because he's addressing the question of whether the law is binding on Gentiles. I think, see, Paul's writing this congregation, this mixed congregation, and this must have been something that's percolating. You have a number of different things, of points of tension between the Jewish and Gentile believers, and Paul wants them all on the same theological page so they'll be united in supporting his mission to Spain. Now, so Paul addresses them, and I think the point is, look, if Jewish converts, when you became a Christian, if you were released from the law, well, then Gentile converts certainly cannot be required to come under the law. You see, so he addresses those who are urging the law's ongoing applicability. And why is he doing that? Well, he makes the point, when he makes that point, then it's clear that you can't bring Gentiles under the law. If you're becoming a Christian, brings you out from under the law. Well, then certainly you can't be arguing that Gentiles who were never under the law in becoming a Christian should come under it. Okay, so I think that's what he's doing there. And when the Jewish Christians, Paul says, when they were in the flesh, that is, without Christ and under the law, when they were relating to God in terms of the bygone Mosaic order, when these Jewish Christians had been doing that, he says the law was an instrument of their death, and that the sinful passions were aroused through it. Now, that to me is an interesting thing, how sin works. That sinful passions were aroused through it. The law was actually used as an obstacle to their bearing fruit to God. But now, having died with Christ and been joined to Christ, they've been released from the law. With the result of what? He says that now you serve in newness of the spirit rather than in oldness of the letter. They live life in the new order. And that's this drastic shift, you see. Under the new covenant, they're no longer under the old covenant. They live life in this new order that is characterized by these new age aspects. A huge one is empowerment by God's Spirit. We live on a different plane. We have been taken out and transformed. We do not live like we lived before. We're not in the same state we were in before. It is a monumental thing that occurs when a person goes from death to life in Christ. And so he's made that point, and we get to chapter 8. He's going to talk a lot about the power of the Spirit. But he goes on here. Chapter 7, verses 7 to 25, is a first read 7 to 12. But as you know, there's a lot of discussion or ideas about what is this division in the eye and all that. And I'll talk about those as we walk through it. But in chapter 7, verses 7 to 12, he says, "What then shall we say? Is the law sin? Absolutely not. Yet I would not have known sin except through the law. For instance, I would not know covetousness, except the law says you shall not covet. But sin, having obtained a base of operations, produced in me through the commandment all kinds of covetousness. For apart from the law, sin is dead. And I was alive apart from the law at one time. But when the commandment came, sin came to life, and I died. And the commandment intended for life, this commandment was found in my case to be for death. For sin, having obtained a base of operations, deceived me through the commandment, and through it killed me. So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. Okay, in saying that the effect of the law was to increase trespasses, he said that in chapter 5, verse 20, was to increase trespasses, and that the effect of the law was to arouse sinful passions, as he said in chapter 7, verse 5. Well, Paul was no doubt accused, or at least he was concerned that he would be accused, of saying that the law was evil and sinful. Well, that's a serious charge. That would be the theological kiss of death. If somebody could convince people that Paul is saying the law of God is sinful and evil, that would be the kiss of death, because it would destroy any continuity between the law and the gospel, between the old and new covenants, between Moses and Christ. And so it would be saying, you've just thrown away everything from the old covenant, all of God's work and what he was doing. You have broken the story. You see, it's not all part of a piece. You've just created something completely different. And so it would be a tremendous place of resistance. But Paul says, look, he flatly rejects the claim that he's saying the law is sinful. What then shall we say? Is the law sin? No. No, the law is not sin. The law is not sinful. He rejects that claim. The law is not itself sin, but the law of Moses and sin do have a definite relationship. They have a definite relationship. The law brings knowledge of sin, as he said in chapter 3, verse 20, in the sense that it shows the real nature and power of sin. Not only does the law provide the opportunity for sin to express itself as transgression, it provides that opportunity, and not only does the law spell out the penalty for sin, that the penalty's wrath and death, but the law, he says now, it's also used by sin to stimulate sinful desires. The law actually takes, sin takes the law and uses it to its evil purposes. Through the law, sin's power is actually enhanced, with the result that one comes to understand the real sinfulness of sin. You see, this is what I see Paul saying. That look, the law here, it is used by sin, that it stimulates the commandments, it uses those commandments to stimulate and to arouse sinful passions. And so the law here, it's sin's power is actually enhanced with the result. What is the result? That we come to really see sin for what it is. Now, when Paul says in chapter 7, verse 8, when he says in verse 8, after noting how sin exploits the command to its own evil purpose, when he says, for apart from law, sin is dead, he means it's dead only in terms of its ability to use the law to stimulate sin, to arouse sinful passions. That particular work of the law of sin requires the law. If there is no law, the sin cannot use the law to arouse sinful passions. So when he says it's dead, he's speaking of that particular function of sin, or that act of sin. He certainly doesn't mean that sin is harmless, or that it's absolutely inactive apart from the law, because he's already explained how all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, even those not under law. And he's already explained how death reigned through sin, even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam's transgression, in chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. So yeah, I think you have to see the context of what Paul means when he says that. And Paul says, at one time, Paul was alive apart from the law. A lot of discussion about what does this mean. I just tell you what I think, right? You know how that works. Okay, this is my understanding of this. Okay, and I think there I can't remember how many different takes there are, but I think Paul, when he says he was alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came to life and he died. And I think he's referring to a time in his youth, a time in his childhood before he was accountable for obeying the law. But as soon as he became mature enough, as soon as he became properly aware, the law then became applicable to him in the sense that he was responsible before God and accountable to God for obeying it. And when that happened, sin living in him sprang into action, producing transgression and consequent death. So that's what I think he's talking about. Now some say, well, this would be at his bar mitzvah, this would be at puberty. I just think there's some point that God knows when a person comes to the level of maturity and understanding that they are then accountable. And I think Paul is saying that when the commandment came, when I reached that level of appreciation, of maturity, of comprehension, that it became applicable to me, and then sin came to life. You see, it sprang, some translations say sprang to life. And so, now Paul doesn't mention this, but let me say as a footnote that commutation of Paul's death sentence would have been available through faith under the law until the coming of Christ. And Paul, as a faithful Jew, certainly would have availed himself of that. He certainly would have been received that commutation, because Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, he was blameless. He was a faithful Jew. So Paul certainly would have received that. Now, with this shift that is affected by Christ's coming, as I've mentioned, that this salvation historical shift that was affected by Christ's coming, forgiveness is no longer available through the old covenant. So when Christ comes, God has turned the page now, and so access to the mercy that is available by faith through the blood of Christ that was available under the old covenant, when he now appears on the scene, he now comes and arrives and says, here I am. The focal point of all divine mercy has appeared on the stage of human history, and he has died and been raised, and there it is. Okay, now, new covenant, that is the sole and exclusive avenue of God's mercy. Okay, so that's just a footnote that would Paul have been lost with all those? No, the faithful Jews under the old covenant would have received commutation of that death sentence. But if I'm right, if Paul is referring to himself, much debate about that, I know that. But if I'm right and that Paul is referring to himself, then he obviously was not born spiritually condemned. You see, rather, Paul was born alive, and then he died when the sinful inclination living in him pulled him to transgress the law. That's when Paul winds up dying. Now, many exegetes, they refuse to consider that Paul is speaking autobiographically here. They refuse to consider that because their interpretation of Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21, that we spent perhaps too long on, but their interpretation of that text convinces them that there was never a time when he was spiritually alive. You see, in their view, everybody is born dead, born guilty, born condemned because of Adam's sin. So there couldn't be a time he was alive. He was born spiritually dead. Okay, since I don't take that view, the view I take is more amenable to what I'm telling you here, is that the autobiographical view where Paul says, look, this is my life, and when I was old enough, the commandment came, sin living in me sprang to life, and I transgressed the commandment, and then I died. And then at the end in verse 12, he says, thus the law is not sinful or evil. And we always have to remember that. You see, we always have to remember the law that was given by God is functioning in God's purpose, and it's not sinful or evil. He says it is holy, righteous, and good. The culprit is what? The culprit is sin. Let's be careful to put the blame where the blame belongs. That's where Paul puts it. The culprit is sin, which uses the law to produce death. So sin uses the law. The culprit is sin. The law is good. The law is holy. The law is righteous. The law is from God. But sin comes in. He personifies sin. Sin comes in and does what? It uses the holy, good, and righteous law to arouse sinful passions so that then we have transgression and then we have death. So Paul's making it, so the idea about the law is an important thing. Then he says in 7:13 to 25, did then that which is good become death to me? Got a hyphen and absolutely that shouldn't be there. Absolutely not. But sin did, in order that it might appear to be sin, producing death in me through that which is good, in order that through the commandment sin might become sinful beyond measure. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am fleshly, having been sold under sin. For I do not know what I carry out, for I do not practice what I will. Rather, I do what I hate. But if I do what I do not will, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I carrying it out, but sin dwelling in me. For I know that good does not dwell in me, that is, in my flesh. For to will the good is present in me, but to carry out the good is not. For I do not do the good that I will, rather I practice the evil that I do not will. But if I do what I do not will, it is no longer I carrying it out, but sin living in me. I find then the law in me who is willing to do good, that evil is present in me. For I delight in God's law in the inner person, but I see another law in my members that is waging war against the law of my mind and making me a captive to the law of sin that is in my members. A wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now therefore, I myself in my mind am a slave to the law of God, but in the flesh, a slave to the law of sin. All right, there's much to be said here. All right. Though sin had killed Paul through the law, okay, as he said in verses 10 and 11 of chapter 7, that doesn't mean the law is culpable in that death. That's what he says, did then that which is good become death to me? Is the law culpable in my death? And his answer is absolutely not. The blame, again, has to be placed on sin, not on the good law that sin used to bring about the death. See, Paul is insisting that we have to keep these things clear. That sin is to blame, the law is not to blame, the law is good. Sin's evil work of using the good law to produce death was used, Paul says, and this is another one of these situations. You see time and again where you have an enemy or an opponent of God's, something working contrary to God's desires, and God then is able to give it rope and have it serve his purpose. You see, who was raging to kill Jesus? Right? Who wants to kill Christ? Kill him. The forces of evil to kill the sinless one. Yes, we will kill him. All of the demonic realm. And what's God doing? Oh, yes. Oh, you killed him. Yes, you hate me. You were raging against me. You wanted to destroy me. And what did I do with that? I took what you intended for evil, and I, because I play so many levels beyond you, I took that and used it for the redemption of the world. All right, so you see this kind of thing, see this, and this is how I look at this here, where he sits here and he says, look, sin's evil work of using the good law to produce death was used to serve the good purpose of revealing the utter sinfulness of sin. Allowing sin to play this hand. Allowing sin to play this hand where it's going to use the law and it's going to stimulate sinful passion. You see, allowing it to play that hand helped to expose sin as the wicked and ferocious power that it is. And this law is what? It is a teacher to lead people to Christ. And see, so Paul says it is not the law, it is sin that is using the good and holy law. But God was able to even incorporate sin's opposition into his larger purpose and have it serve as a means of exposing the wickedness of sin. Okay, so he says, you know, that sin would be clearly seen for the wicked and ferocious power that it is. Then in verses 14 to 25, he elaborates on sin's work in bringing about transgression through the law. And this is where a lot of the discussion is. I think I saw 10 different views on who is the I that Paul refers to. There are, I think, 4 dominant ones. Cruz in his commentary refers to 10 of them. So I'm not going to go through all those. I'll just tell you what I think, how I see it, and then you guys can chew on it and see what you think. Okay, Paul says the law is spiritual, meaning the law is in harmony with God, but we humans, Paul is referring to himself as a representative human, but we humans are not that way. He says we are fleshly. We are oriented away from God in that we have been what? Sold under sin. That's quite a phrase. We have been sold under sin. See, this is mankind's condition in Adam. You see, that's this idea of that somehow this sinful inclination, sinful proclivity, we have been sold under sin. It is not a person's condition in Christ, as I see what Paul says just in chapter 6. We went through this, but I wanted to pull out these various verses so you can see in 6:2, absolutely not. We died to sin. How shall we still live in it? Verse 6, knowing that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be nullified, that we might no longer serve sin as slaves. Verse 11, so also you must consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but living to God in Christ Jesus. Verse 14, for sin will not exercise lordship over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. You're in the new state, you're under a new covenant. Okay, verses 17 and 18, but thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you obeyed from the heart the pattern of teaching to which you were delivered, and having been freed from sin, were enslaved to righteousness. Verse 22, but now having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you have your fruit leading to sanctification. The end is eternal life. Okay, so when I look at these things, what he's talking about here, he's talking about, and even if we could even look in Romans chapter 6, verses 12 and 13. You see, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1 shows that Christians can choose to be fleshly. We can choose to be fleshly. We can fail to appropriate the emancipation that we have from the clutches of sin that Paul describes in chapter 6. But that's different from never having been emancipated. We can choose, we can go ahead, and even in chapter 6, verses 12 and 13, where he says, do not allow sin to rule. Okay, what that mean? That means that I could allow sin to rule. I could go in and say, okay, no, I'm going to come back and serve sin and put myself at sin's disposal. But I've been emancipated. You see? 6, 12, and 13, he says, don't offer your bodily members to be used as weapons of unrighteousness. So you could do that. But I want you to see that is not the state of a person. A person in Christ has been emancipated. The power that keeps us from honoring God has been broken. It is very important because I think, as I said last week, we have so much focused on the forensic aspect of Christianity. The notion that when I'm forgiven, okay, I'm a Christian, now I'm forgiven, and everything else is the same. And that's not true. That is not true. There is a radical difference in a person's life, in a person's power, and in their state. They rise to walk in newness of life. They walk in a new state. And that state is one that's characterized by the powers of the new age, primarily or largely the power of God's Spirit. Now, speaking from this perspective of enslavement to sin, which I see as he's talking about in Adam, pre-conversion, speaking from that perspective of enslavement to sin, Paul says that though part of him realizes the goodness of the law and longs to obey it, he winds up transgressing the law because sin, or the sinful inclination, or the sinful proclivity that dwells within him, pulls him into disobedience. You see, sin personified as this power, as this force. Sin keeps that part of him that wants to obey from taking over the mind and will to the extent that it can effectively and consistently direct the body to do the good. His body is thus, it is under the dominion of sin, sinful passions. Paul says it is captive to its rule in verse 23, with the result that it is, in verse 24, body of death under sin's condemnation. I'm going through all this because this is important to me in understanding who is the I he's talking about. You see, I'm convinced and feel pretty strongly about it, that the I is somebody who's outside of Christ. And there are a lot of people that would take issue with that. As Paul looks back on his pre-Christian sin, see, he's looking back as a Christian, back on his pre-Christian sin, and he looks back with the post-Christian knowledge that mercy was no longer available under the old covenant, and in doing that, he expresses the anguish of a condemned man. Because he looks back on his sin, he said, well, I'm doomed. Who can save me from this body of death, this body that has earned condemnation? Now that I look back and I see that there was no mercy any longer available under the old covenant, who can save me? Who can rescue me? I'm just in a terrible state. And then he praises God. Thanks be to God through the Christ who saved me. You see, and that's what I think Paul is doing. And in the last verse, 25, the last part there, I think he just recaps the dividedness of the I that he's portrayed in verses 15 through 23. His mind, at least part of it, is committed to the law of God, but the flesh is committed to the law of sin. Okay, so that's, I think he's just painting again this dividedness. And he's talking about, I'm convinced this is the struggle that a Christian has. Now you remember here, some weeks ago I shared with you this quote from James Dunn from his book, The Theology of Paul the Apostle. And he says, the issue of personal responsibility, Paul tried to resolve by depicting sin as a power which fully masters the fleshly eye, without really denying the eye's part in the evil it does or exculpating its failure to do the good. And you can see that, for example, in verse 17, he says, no longer I carrying it out, but sin dwelling in me. But then he says in verse 19, I do not do the good I will. I practice the evil I do not will. So yeah, this is what I think. I think Paul is content, as I said weeks ago, to simply leave the tension there. That we are, in some sense, outside of Christ, enslaved and captive, and yet culpable. And so that's, I like Dunn's statement of it, and that's why I've given it to you twice. So Paul has, let me read you, this is a statement, brief statement of Gordon Fee. This is from Fee's book on God's empowering presence, the Holy Spirit, in the letters of Paul. And he says, there are three matters which seem overwhelmingly to favor the view that Paul is here in this last part of chapter 7, this I stuff, that Paul is here describing life before and outside of Christ, but from the perspective of one who is now in Christ. And that's how I see that. And this, the three points that Fee makes, that he says these three matters seem overwhelmingly to favor the view. And I'm with Fee. I mean, I feel strongly about this. But the three points, to summarize his point, is that the only questions raised by Paul here have to do with life under the law, not with life in Christ, which clearly is not under the law. That's what Paul's been talking about. You were here, and then you've moved here. You've moved to this new state. You're under grace, not under law, under grace, and those being terms of old and new covenant. So that's the first point. The second is that the Spirit, who is a key to living under the new covenant, is not mentioned. You'll see Paul in chapter 8, he talks so much about the Spirit of God who is generally available, that you and I are empowered by God's Spirit to live lives to God's glory. Do we believe that? You see, this is the idea of this radical righteousness that we have through God's Spirit to live on a completely different plane than we did before. We were what? Enslaved, addicted, caught, tangled. And part of the good news is that Christ can free you from that. He doesn't simply forgive you and leave you in the pig pen. He loves you too much for that. And so he has empowered us to live lives to his glory, to break free from the bondage of sin. And that bondage is no picnic. I know the world. I know the world's faces. No, this is really what's great. No, this is life. This is really what's life. Oh, those religious folks over there, you leave them alone. They're all hayseeds, haters. You just stay away. This is life. I understand how the world works. I understand how the powers behind the world work. You see, but Paul said, look, we are freed from sin by the power of God's Spirit, and it's absolutely essential. The third point is that the description of this person as being sold under sin and thoroughly captivated by it is completely incompatible with Paul's view of life in Christ, which is a victorious life empowered by the Spirit and no longer enslaved to sin. That was the point when I was reading all those things from chapter 6. When I look, he says, you're captive to sin, you're enslaved to it, and all this. I just have trouble with the idea. How do you think that can describe the life of a Christian after what Paul said in chapter 6? I just have trouble with that. I know there are smart, good people who look at it differently, but they're not teaching the class today. Okay? So this is, I just look at this and I say, look, this seems to me to be an important thing. And I think it's important for us. That's part of the good news. Part of the good news is deliverance. Can we say it that way? It's deliverance from the power of sin so that you no longer have to be the person who struggles here and who hates the things that you do. There is forgiveness and cleansing, but there's power. And there's power to live a new life. And I'm so thankful to God for that. Thanks for coming. Next week, Lord willing.